Okay, hello everybody. Thank you for attending the last presentation of the day. I know that some of you are probably a bit tired, so I'll try to be as efficient and brief as possible. So today's presentation is about IPMX, the Internet Protocol Media Experience. And for those of you not familiar with it, it's very close to something that you do know. It derives almost entirely from SMPTE 2110. So what is in IPMX is essentially built off of SMPTE 2110, where a few things that are defined in SMPTE 2110 as if you're going to do something, do it this way. We actually make some of those features mandatory in IPMX so that they're always present in IPMX implementations. And there are some open specifications that were added in AMWA, NMOS, and VSF to complete the IPMX specification. So the NMOS is already popularly used, the ISO 4 and ISO 5 already very popular with SMPTE 2110, but SMPTE 2110 was already codified before those were ready. So in IPMX, this is now also mandatory. So what are some of the value propositions of IPMX? So first of all, IPMX is based on SMPTE and is entirely intended to remain compatible and superset the functionality of 2110. One of those supersets is to add support for asynchronous signals, and we'll deal with that in this presentation. To work with or without PTP, another critical new superset feature. As I said, ISO 4 and ISO 5 are now mandatory. The enabling of simpler networks. So one of the design goals of IPMX was to relax a little bit the ability to build simpler networks, and we'll discuss how and what that means in this presentation. But also maintaining the ability to support large and complex networks. The native compatibility with SMPTE 2110 so that we could mix IPMX with SMPTE 2110. And the added support for RGB. So RGB is already specified in SMPTE 2110, but it's not implemented by a lot of different products in the market. With IPMX, we make it a mandatory supported element to facilitate interoperability and add usefulness to the products. So let's take a quick look at the penetration of 2110 right now. It's obviously growing in experience, in trust, in live implementations, and live production is already using this quite a bit. And with that comes added user experiences, what worked well, what didn't. So a lot of this is what's involved in informing the IPMX specifications. There's already a bunch of other derivatives of SMPTE that are in the market as well, so IPMX is no exception. So in medical, DICOM RTV has basically borrowed from SMPTE 2110 and added support for some DICOM metadata to create some workflows particular to medical. And in the defense market, they're also using SMPTE 2110. But IPMX focused on adding some usefulness to the broadcast market and also Pro-EV, and we'll cover that right now. So in terms of who's behind IPMX, it's the familiar faces. The same stakeholders that essentially built SMPTE 2110 are also the ones building IPMX. The only distinction is that there are also some indigenous to Pro-EV companies that have now joined VSF and Ames and other organizations and added their voice. But a lot of the organizations are familiar faces and are the very same companies that got behind SMPTE 2110 in the first place. So what is IPMX? Essentially, it's a transport, discovery, and control protocol. And it's designed to serve beyond just the broadcast workflows, a bunch of additional workflows that are, some of them are listed here for the Pro-EV market, for example. But essentially, it deals with live media, corporate communications, and high-impact live operations and decision-making. So it's very, very similar to what we're doing in broadcast with SMPTE 2110 today, but with a little bit of flexibility added to SMPTE 2110. So some of the goals of IPMX are making things easier to use and deploy, supporting more off-the-shelf networking and a broader array of network products, supporting existing infrastructures a little bit more flexibly, supporting desktop content a little bit more flexibly, so a little bit better support for non-camera content, so things with sharp text and Excel spreadsheets with lines that are only 1 pixel thick and things of this type. Obviously, maintaining support for uncompressed media for no compromise environments, including, of course, audio. Providing a very good latency experience, same as SMPTE 2110. Supporting, as I said earlier, asynchronous signals. Adding support for simpler networks and peer-to-peer modes. Adding support for HDCP. Adding support for more flexible software-based workflows and how we relax some of the aspects of SMPTE 2110 to make software-based workflows a little bit easier to implement. And more interoperability between asset classes and brands. So when we cover the IPMX main components, obviously the heart of it is the transport is based entirely on SMPTE 2110. And as I said, we add ISO 4 and ISO 5, which came shortly after SMPTE 2110 was codified. We add EDID management through NMOS IS 11. Content protection based on HDCP. Codec support to handle desktop content. So let's look at the first one here, so the transport based on SMPTE 2110. So here are some of the assumptions that exist in SMPTE 2110 today that are important to consider. So one of the things is that SMPTE 2110 assumes that PTP is present. That's a big assumption. It also assumes that signals like SDI inputs, for example, and audio inputs are already genlocked and aligned to the PTP epoch. And although non-PTP is specified in SMPTE 2110, and although RGB is specified in SMPTE 2110, it's around, but it's not actually well supported. So this is what IPMX adds. It uses SMPTE 2110 without modification whenever possible. But it also makes it mandatory instead of optional to work on networks without PTP, although it fully supports networks with PTP in the SMPTE 2110 way. It adds new PTP profiles that are a little bit easier to support, which I'll cover in this presentation. It adds a mechanism to deal with signals that are not genlocked, and it makes support for RGB mandatory. So let's get into a few pictures. So let's start with a network that has no PTP on the network itself. So like SMPTE 2110, IPMX follows exactly the same recipe of providing synchronization for video, audio, and ancillary data that are provided as separate flows. So from an IPMX sender to an IPMX receiver, you achieve a very simple connectivity through the network. Even without PTP, we're able to maintain, at least through the internal clock of the sender, coordination and synchronization between the video, audio, and ancillary flows. So when you add more receivers, we could maintain the audio, video, ancillary sync from the sender on the different receivers. The clock here comes from the sender. So again, this is a network without PTP. Now, what happens when there's multiple senders? So here, because we're using the internal clock of the sender, we can keep video and audio synchronized, and receivers could receive synchronized video and audio from different senders, but we still haven't introduced a mechanism to keep the receivers aware of the different clocks of the different senders. So we can't yet synchronize the different senders to the different senders, but it's still very useful on a network without PTP to keep all of these senders and all of these receivers able to transmit synchronized video and audio from sender to receiver. This is very simple networking so far, and very good flexibility to add. Another thing that we can do is from the same sender that's able to send out multiple flows with, let's say, two video and two audio streams. Obviously, the receiver is able to receive the video and audio from the same sender, and here the video and audio from both the red flow and the red and the blue flows are based on the same internal clock of the sender. So this is in fact all in sync, even on the network without PTP. So we're going to talk a little bit about PTP, and then we're going to introduce full PTP as well as a lighter level of PTP on this network and see what happens. So as a quick refresher, what is PTP? PTP is used as a common reference clock. All devices' internal clocks are synchronized to it. This enables all of the senders and receivers to share the same time, and RTP timestamps from all of the devices have the same common reference. So this is what happens when we introduce, on the same picture as before, PTP from the network. So now that PTP is available from the network, obviously all of the senders and receivers that are IPMX senders and receivers can now use that PTP signal, and all of the devices can be synchronized. And now all of the video flows, audio flows, and ancillary flows are all synchronized with the same clock. What's new in IPMX is that the IPMX Grandmaster, although it can, does not require as much accuracy as with SMPTE 2110. This is intending to enable a little bit less complexity, a little bit more access to more networking equipment, and a little bit easier to implement in software workflows. So let's take a look at what that means in a table. This is SMPTE 2110 compared to IPMX when it comes to the Grandmaster. So both are based on 8 syncs per second. However, the delay request to sync on IPMX is 1 to 32 compared to 1 to 1 with SMPTE 2110. It's practical to put this in an example with a lot of devices on your network. Let's say you have 100 devices on your network. Because of the one-to-one ratio in SMPTE 2110, if you have 100 devices times 8 sync requests per second, that's basically 8 requests and 800. That's 800 requests and 800 answers per second. So that's 1600 messages per second, and this is what ends up causing some of the specialized requirements on the networking equipment, and what makes it sensitive for equipment. Let's say you want to do software-based workflows. It's, you know, you need a pretty specialized NIC card or implementation on that system to be able to participate with this level of synchronization. It's a lot of effort to just keep track of the sync. Now, beyond this, some manufacturers even recommend 32 syncs per second, which it just quadruples the problem. So we're talking about 6,400 messages per second for 100 devices on your network. So IPMX relaxes this. It's greatly reducing the number of messages for these 100 assets, and it makes it a little bit easier to network and to support software-based workflows, especially for compressed media. Now keep in mind, I said that this is in addition to, so the IPMX devices still support the full SMPTE level of synchronized fidelity if you want to use it that way. So if there's a Grandmaster on the network that has the sync ratio 1-to-1 with 8 syncs per second or even 32 syncs per second, IPMX devices will continue to support that. So we're just introducing new lower level fidelity for better networking options, but we're not sacrificing the ability to synchronize to higher levels of fidelity. They're both present. So here's one thing that we're going to introduce now where we could have that benefit of the slightly lighter PTP and also the ability to take advantage of IPMX devices acting as the PTP Grandmaster. So we can inherit the grandmaster from the network if it's available. If there's no grandmaster on the network, we could also introduce PTP into the network. This is also a very, very useful feature. This allows us to essentially create a PTP environment without there being a really high fidelity grandmaster on the network present. So in this example, we're taking the gold receiver, and the gold receiver is receiving the media, but is acting as the PTP grandmaster. So the sender here and the three other receivers are synchronizing to the PTP clock from the gold receiver, which is acting as the PTP grandmaster. So again, the PTP grandmaster could be on the sender side, or it could be on the receiver side. This is not important. What's important is that we're able to introduce PTP in an easier way, in a simpler network, as an option. It's a new option. Now let's review the sources. We're so far only dealing with the whether PTP is present on the network or not, but we also have to deal with another assumption that was made in SMPTE 2110, which is all of the sources are synchronized. So in broadcast, the signals are locked to a house sync, and it makes it a lot easier for SMPTE 2110 to deal with that. In IPMX, we expand that to also deal with sources that are not synchronized, and we'll see some pictures of that shortly and what the benefit of that is. So just as a quick refresher, RTP timestamps. So these are already public specifications, how to generate RTP timestamps. You know, video uses fields and frames to generate these. Audio uses ticks per packet. So although the mechanisms are different, the outcome is the same. We basically have timestamps that are information that we use to orchestrate and synchronize all of the devices. So we needed to add some stuff to support asynchronous signals to expand a little bit more what you can do with SMPTE 2110, and that's one of the things that IPMX tackled. So what we added was mandatory RTCP sender reports to describe the relationship between the timestamps and the reference clock. So by adding these RTCP sender reports, we're able to introduce asynchronous signals into SMPTE environments and into IPMX environments. In terms of traffic shaping models, all this means is a little bit more flexibility. So everything that we have in SMPTE 2110 is kept. All of the abilities to support synchronous signals is kept. But what we're adding is a little bit of flexibility to add asynchronous signals while maintaining low latency and while keeping the buffer requirements low to keep the cost and complexity low. So in terms of the gap read space, it's also assumed to require a smaller receive buffer and keep, again, the complexity and the cost low. Another thing we're going to look at is link offset delay. So this is a concept that already exists in AES67. So the audio protocol that is in SMPTE 2110 already uses this to align the audio output of various receivers. And SMPTE 2110 doesn't absolutely mandate the support for this control, although it defines it. With IPMX, we also make this mandatory, and we also introduce the use of NMOS ISO5 to control it. So the link offset delay in IPMX consists of using the definitions in SMPTE 2110 plus the NMOS ISO5 to control it. So let's look at the effects of some of this. So here in the picture, we have a sender and a couple of receivers. So obviously, all of the receivers are impacted by the same the transmission delay. So that's common amongst all receivers. We don't need to deal with that so much. But the network delay per receiver may vary, and the processing delay per receiver may vary. So link offset delay deals with that. The little pink that you're seeing here basically takes the worst case maximum delay combined network plus processing delay in the receivers and the biggest one becomes the boundary that we have to align to. So the other receivers, we introduce a little bit extra delay to all of those other receivers so that all of the receivers line up perfectly. Now, keep in mind, we're talking about microseconds of latency here. We're not talking about big latencies. Even without the link offset delay, everything is very, very, very tight. But this is just to make it perfect. ISO 4, this is what deals with asset discovery and registration API. And we added the peer-to-peer support. Again, making this mandatory in IPMX to support peer-to-peer mode. More useful on the same subnet, smaller networks. Obviously, we still depend on a registry when we have a lot of assets that we need to coordinate. And also the support for the query API. So this is what allows us to interview our network and see how many senders and receivers we have, how many flows we have to manage, and what kinds of flows. And ISO 5 is the basic control API. And this is what allows us to do the routing of the audio and video signals and connect senders to receivers. And again, IPMX is making use of this to also control the link offset delay so that we have that nice experience that I just showed earlier where we're dealing with network delay and receiver processing delays. IS11 is what we use to deal with EDID. This is something that we're introducing with IPMX, is dealing with EDIDs. We didn't have to deal with EDID in broadcast with SDI, but it's very, very practical to deal with EDID because what happens when your sources are computers and your destinations are displays? You know, in the AV world, you can connect the HDMI cable from your source to your TV, and automatically the computer says, I intend to send you some video and some audio. And the display very quickly responds, well, fine, here are a bunch of resolutions that I support, and here's my favorite one. And then the computer sends that resolution and that audio to the display, and you get a very nice plug-and-play experience. Now, what happens when we introduce a network in between that source and that display? So we have to deal with that EDID management through an IP intermediary, and this is what IS11 deals with. And there's even more complexity when you have that same source that wants to talk to a bunch of displays where it's in multicast mode and you have a bunch of receivers. So we have to manage this now, one sender to multiple receivers that each have different EDIDs. So we deal with that as well with IS11. And of course, now that we're dealing with the HDMI world and we're dealing with EDID, we're also dealing with the question of, well, what if it's protected content? What if my source is a media player and I need to deal with protected content? So we deal with this as well. This was already well defined in the DCP Adaptation Amendment Rev 2.3. It defines how to deal with HTCP over IP. It just didn't define how to do the key exchange. So we deal with that with IPMX, how to do the key exchange from the sources and the destinations. And this is called HTCP Key Exchange Protocol. And this is what is also in IPMX. So we're going to revisit our pictures before with senders and receivers. And now we're going to introduce some of these elements and see how we could take advantage of these in broadcast examples. I didn't include any Pro EV examples since this is a broadcast show. But there's a lot of benefits in Pro EV workflows as well. But we'll deal with just broadcast examples. So here's example number one. We'll take a 1 gig switch. We're going to assume right now that we're going to do a little compressed media network here in broadcast. We're going to introduce our SDI equipment. Obviously, this is already house synced. And we're going to drop in two IPMX senders that are grabbing these SDI sources and putting them onto the network as JPEG XS compressed media. So we can already receive this on IPMX receivers, and this could be in hardware or in software. So already right here, the ease of networking, very nice, very convenient. With IPMX, we use ISO 4 and ISO 5 to make the networking experience very smooth, and we make the media compatible with the essence of SMPTE 2110 using JPEG, JPEG XS, which is SMPTE 2110-22. But we also use the link offset delay to synchronize these outputs. So that's where, by introducing PTP Grandmaster on one of the pieces of equipment, that's IPMX here, and by introducing the link offset delay, we're able to align these perfectly as well. So we can create a nice little PTP network here without a lot of complexity. Very simple network, very simple switch, and all of the work is being done by the IPMX senders and receivers themselves, and leveraging ISO 4 and ISO 5 and link offset delay within the equipment. So let's expand this example a little bit. So we'll keep that we just did. We aligned the SDI outputs of the receivers here. We have this little IPMX network. Let's go ahead and attach this little IPMX network to the main broadcast 2110 network. Let's now deal with the bigger network, where we're dealing with a combination of compressed and uncompressed media. We're going to take the PTP from the bigger network, and we're going to use the PTP from the bigger network on the smaller IPMX network. Now, this yellow arrow is bidirectional. The media is going to be going from the IPMX network into the SMPTE network, but we are taking the PTP from the PTP network, on the 2110 network, and using that PTP instead of the Grandmaster being on one of the IPMX devices. So now we're using PTP from the bigger SMPTE 2110 network, and we're sending media into the broadcast network. So now you see the compressed media appearing either on the main trunk itself, or you could also extend it to other smaller IPMX networks that are connected to the main SMPTE 2110 network. So what you have here are a bunch of little islands of IPMX broadcast networks that are all connected to a main SMPTE 2110 network that is controlling the PTP. So obviously you have to have PTP aware switches to be able to do this type of thing, but it does greatly simplify your networking on these smaller IPMX networks. Here's another thing that we're going to look at. We're going to deal with uncompressed on the big network here. So we have the uncompressed media, we have the house sync to synchronize the sources. So far, this is all synchronized sources with SMPTE 2110 senders and receivers with SMPTE 2110 on the network. Let's drop IPMX equipment directly onto this network and see what happens. So here's an IPMX sender that we're adding, so a second SDI connection, and this time it's going into an IPMX sender, which again is just a superset of a SMPTE 2110 sender. And we're going to add an IPMX receiver here. So what mixing and matching is possible? So can I take my SMPTE 2110 sender, which is the blue SDI source, and send it to my IPMX receiver? Yes, this is possible. So my IPMX sender can send and be received by both the IPMX receiver and the SMPTE 2110 receiver, and my SMPTE 2110 sender can send the content to my IPMX receiver and my SMPTE 2110 receiver as well. We saw that earlier, and here it is on the IPMX receiver. So the other thing that we did by dealing with asynchronous sources is now we can add asynchronous sources into this network. This is a new feature of IPMX. So now, because we're dealing with the way to support asynchronous sources into this workflow, now we can take those asynchronous sources and drop them in here. And the same receivers that are able to receive SMPTE 2110 sender media or IPMX sender media can also receive the IPMX asynchronous sources. And you can use them on both the IPMX and the SMPTE receivers on this network. So we're just adding to your environment. We're not taking anything away. These are just new incremental options from 6 months ago. We're also going to show the compressed media being mixed in. We already had looked at this in the previous slide, but we're going to mix it in here. Here I'm assuming a multi-viewer that natively supports a JPEG XS compressed media out, and we're connecting this to the 2110 network. So again, it's the same thing. We can add it directly to media on this network, or we could bring it to a smaller IPMX network that is connected downstream. So this is your main network and your smaller derivative network configuration that is very, very nice in flexibility, reduces some network complexity, makes it easier for you to mix and match your different assets. So that was a very quick review. And one thing to keep in mind is that IPMX, the standards, are supersetting SMPTE and a few other open specifications. Another thing that we're making an effort to do to make it easier to work with IPMX assets is we're defining some profiles. This will help identify, even though the standards support uncompressed media and compressed media and a bunch of other things like asynchronous sources and introducing PTP by ourselves onto IPMX networks, we do have an effort underway to define some IPMX profiles that make it a little bit easier for all of you to figure out, okay, how do I guarantee that my media from vendor one is going to interoperate with my media from vendor two? So we're creating a little bit of a profile map to help with that. So a device can support profile one, or it can support profile two, or it can support profile one and two, and this gives you a very clear map of what works with what out of the box, with a lot of the work already taken out of the equation for making the stuff connect together. The last thing that I want to show, and then we'll be wrapped up for today, is what we already showed at the last event, where we mixed Pro EV stuff with broadcast stuff. So we designed a demonstration. There were a couple of different brands involved. There was a transcoder server from Intel transcoding uncompressed media to SMPTE 2110-22, so JPEG XS. There was a bunch of SMPTE 2110 encoders and decoders, including the ROS Video Newt, and there was a SMPTE 2110 camera in the demo. We had some different NMOS controllers in the demo. We had different networking products, some from Cisco, some from Arista, some from Netgear, each doing different things. We had some software endpoints. On the Intopix booth, we were using a Nook. On the Macnica booth, we were using a laptop to show IPMX flows. And we had a bunch of IPMX encoders and decoders, and we had an LED wall processor that was ingesting IP media into an LED wall. So here's a picture of what was networked together and what we were able to achieve very straightforward. Actually, it was a very nice demo. So we built first an authentic broadcast network. This was a SMPTE 2110 network with Arista switch, with PTP Grandmaster on that network. We had some cameras and some other sources connected to encoders that were using uncompressed media on the broadcast network. We also had the Intel server that was doing the -20 to -22 conversion directly on that network. And we connected the Arista switch to a Cisco switch. Now, the Cisco switch was deliberately configured to be an uncompressed media switch with no PTP. So we were not using PTP on the Cisco switch. It was an asynchronous network. And we had a bunch of additional encoders and decoders that were IPMX on the asynchronous network. And one of the pieces of equipment that was connected to the Cisco switch was the megapixel VR direct view LED wall processor, and this was ingesting the media through uncompressed IP port. And we were showing on the LED wall everything that we've discussed so far. We were showing the uncompressed media from the broadcast network, the compressed media from the broadcast network, and the uncompressed media from the IPMX network, all on the LED wall. Another switch that we connected to the Arista switch was a Netgear switch, and the model that we picked was on purpose not supporting PTP. So we had a second non-PTP network, and this was intended to show the compressed media. So we were taking the broadcast content from the broadcast network And the Intel server that was converting the dash 20 to dash 22, we took that dash 22 content, the JPEG XS media, and we distributed it on a Pro AV network. So all of that JPEG XS content was now on an asynchronous network, and we were showing it on laptops, on NUCs, on IPMX receivers that were hardware-based. So a mix of hardware and software-based receivers, all being able to show that content very comfortably on that demonstration. And last but not least, we also showed a little bit of gatewaying to illustrate that IPMX intends to connect to as many things as possible. We had an HD-based T to IPMX gateway on the network as well. So we took some HD-based T cameras, and we connected them to devices that converted that to IPMX, and we put them through the same switch that was carrying the Dash 22 JPEG XS broadcast content, and we were distributing it on exactly the same asynchronous Pro AV network. So we were showing HD-based T equipment on the Pro AV network, some direct IPMX compressed content on that network, and some of the broadcast content that was also on that network. So this Pro AV network was showing all of the things that you will find in a typical Pro AV network, as well as the stuff that was on the broadcast network. So at the next event, we're going to be showing the reverse direction. We're going to be taking content from a non-PTP network, and we're going to be introducing it into the live production environment that is running with a PTP switch, with PTP on the network. So that'll be for ISC 2023. Hope to see you there. Thank you very much for joining this presentation.